I certainly can't predict how long the clarity I'm feeling this morning will persist. It's unlike me to be reporting on such an instantaneous quote new unquote idea or experience. But the clarity that just wafted over me is that the quote work unquote is the life of the few. That the work is not, never has been, never will be, the life of the many. The work is not and has not been since we became agrarian complex and therefore toxic cultures, has never been the masses, the millions. The work is the few. Keeping them alive, giving them life. Maybe this will vanish from me in hours. Or maybe it's the way I'll understand life for the rest of mine. The latter will be the more true understanding. Duh. I mean, when in history even this instantaneous reflection on my studies. When in history do we look at a time, do we look at a culture, do we look at a city, do we look at a country and say, oh my goodness, the masses were human, the masses were humane, the masses were goodness, the masses were saints? Au contraire. Those who retained the pure goodness in which they were born are the entire extreme exception for as long as memory goes back. Wow. Wow. And by what objective thought is this changeable? By what objective thought is this mass insanity that's persisted throughout the ages, this mass inhumanity, By what thought is this, for want of the right idea, for want of the right example, for want of the right key, the right awakening, the right path breaking, better than Jesus? Better than Eleanor Roosevelt? Better than King? Better than Gandhi? Better than Jesus' teaching? What circumstance, what cataclysm have we been missing that will cause the mass persistent awakening of humanity? I'm open to seeing it. Oh, I'm yearning to see it. I've lived 59 years in the illusion that it exists. But this morning I look with more honest eyes. And can't, as I sit here, imagine what the objective circumstance is. Unless it has to do with environmental genocide, environmental suicide through a combination of overcrowding, overpollution, overconsumption. But I really don't see that why that would change our nature. The other thing that occurs to me is the massive aha I had sitting here 2 or 3 months ago. That the best science on the gratification of the human being says that joy and optimal experience are to be found in not the resource-rich, but the resource-poor environment. So could it be that our instrumentation, our ability to measure, our ability to show that measurement is the answer? That's new. It could be. As I've fantasized for a decade or more, if there were a meter I could wear on my wrist like a watch that would show me the chemical readout. Conclusively showing me the zero-sum trade-off between superior joy and grotesquely inferior pleasure. Could that do it? Well, maybe so. But more examples? Not necessarily more examples, but what if the examples that have existed throughout the ages could be quantified with that fictitious or placeholding meter on the wrist? Maybe. What does this mean for start going forward? Wow. If this morning's thought persists, it will certainly be quite a while to unpack. But initial thoughts include, soon a greater immersion in psychology, psychological research, psychological studies to substantiate, and maintaining what I've been doing, being as healthy and alive and humane a being as I can be, for the greed of it, for the joy of it. And knowing that the example that provides, the path that that blazes, can increase the odds, at least by some infinitesimal amount, the possibility of others following.